A very good evening to all my literature lovers and dear audience. This is Deepika back again with a very interesting and curious topic, which is the art and science of economic policy by one and only Ajay Shah. Ajay Shah studied at IIT Bombay and USC Los Angeles. He has held positions at the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, Indira Gandhi Institute for Development Research and the Ministry of Finance. Sir is now professor at NIPFP in New Delhi. He does academic and policy-oriented research on India at the intersection of economics, law, and public administration. We also having with us our dear moderator, Kautilya Chajet. Sir have been involved in training and consulting for more than 10 years with the intention of dramatically increasing profit, productivity, and the performance of people. A master corporate trainer associated with many companies and educational institutions. Sir have delivered a wide variety of management and professional development workshops. His experience and association with people from various domains help him to effectively manage people and their behavior. He travels widely and enjoys working with all level of employees, from top level management to operators level. He is also a freelance writer with a few newspapers. Prior, sir was working with Videocon International Ltd in Mumbai as a manager. Now, I would like to hand over this session over to you guys.
Thank you so much. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Ajay Shah. And everyone attending the session here. Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Ajay Shah. Am I audible to him? Am I audible, Mr. Ajay Shah? I'm not sure if I'm audible to. We are here to talk about the book In the Service of the Republic, The Art and Science of Policy Making. It's kind of a guide or a Bible for policy making, I believe. In the Service of the Republic is a meticulously researched work that stands at the intersection of economics, political and philosophy and public administration. It's a highly readable book. Lays out the art and the science of policy making. That we need. Yes, what's happening? Hello?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me? Am I audible to you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm able to hear you.
Yeah. Session is yours, sir.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Good evening, Mr. Ajay Shah. Am I audible to you?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Ajay Shah, and good evening, everyone attending the session here. I'm the moderator here for the session today, and in conversation with Mr. Ajay Shah on his book, Service of the Republic, The Art and Science of Policy Making. This is a highly readable book, lays out on the art and science of policy making we need. Before we start with the book, I have a personal question to you, Mr. Ajay Shah. You are an engineer, and from engineer to economics, why it happened or how it happened?
Well, my father was an economist, so I always had a fair amount of knowledge and exposure to economics. Then I, like every other 12th standard child in India, I thought I should go to attend an IIT. So I was in IIT Bombay for 4 years. And then I had to think about what to do next. And the way I always say it is that physics was too difficult, engineering was too easy. So I chose the Goldilocks field. Economics is, you know, sufficiently difficult to be interesting, but not really difficult like physics. So one can hope to make some progress. So that is how I ended up in economics.
Okay. So you will actually give it credit to your father being an economist, or you will be like, economics is an easier field, that's why he chose economics as in compared to physics? What exactly?
Both. Yeah, both were true. Yeah.
Okay. So before we start, as in, I would like to ask a basic question on the book, as in what made you write this book? What exactly is the background behind this book?
Okay. So Vijay Kelkar is a famous Indian economist and policymaker. He's one generation ahead of me. So we have a 23-year age gap between us. And he was my boss in the Ministry of Finance many, many years ago. So we've been working together now for 21 years. And we've both been thinking deeply about the Indian story, about what worked and what didn't work in India's plan. Now, by and large, 1991 to 2011 worked out reasonably well. All in all, we got some pretty good growth in those 20 years. And in the period after 2011, things have not gone well. So we felt that we should write this book because this is a very critical moment in India's history. We need to understand what has gone wrong, and we need to change course. We need to lay the intellectual raw material and the foundations for a next phase of 20 years of great growth. So that was our motivation on why write this book and why now. And I think it's particularly appropriate as it's a collaboration between two generations. Vijay Kelkar comes from one generation in front of me. I am in the middle of my life today. So we are two different generations, and this is what we are able to agree on.
Right. And what exactly is the theory behind the book or the concept behind the book? What do you want to as in highlight?
Okay. The big idea of the book is that we were told a certain story about the 91 reforms. Right. We were all told a story, and I'm going to argue that this story is not true. We were told a story that there was some old Indian socialism, and you know, there used to be central planning and license, permit, raid, Raj, and all entrepreneurs in India were terrorized. And then we got the 91 reforms and all our problems got solved. Well, the main argument of this book is that in fact, we have not solved these problems. That to be a private person in India is to face very significant intervention and interference in your life from the government. That the government of India continues to interfere and meddle in our lives in a thousand ways. And that this is the central problem that is holding India back. That they've really not done enough in terms of achieving freedom. That there is a vast administrative state, there's an official machinery which will constantly interfere in your life. They have arbitrary power. There is a lack of rule of law. And in this environment, we the people become disheartened. Then entrepreneurs don't invest and the firms don't build capabilities. And then we as India get stuck. Okay, so this is the big idea of the book, that the 91 reforms actually only scratch the surface. And there is a ton of work waiting to be done to achieve greater freedom for the people of India.
So that's the main idea, that private sector are more important to actually grow, as in to give a boost in the economy, as you mean to say that? That's the basic idea?
So in every country in the world, wherever prosperity has been created, prosperity has only been created by the private sector.
Yeah.
Okay, so it is only private people who can build companies, who can make jobs. Okay? The government of India is not going to be able to give jobs to the mass of people of India. Okay? Government of India is a drop in the ocean. We need, you know, 500 million, 600 million, 700 million jobs. and the government can make 20 million, 30 million jobs. So the government is irrelevant in the overall story of the prosperity of India. Prosperity can only come from private people. But for that, you need a government that works. We need a government that functions. Okay, the income tax has to be done sensibly. The financial regulation has to be done sensibly. The banks should not collapse. RBI should not run a central planning system telling you how to run a bank, and so on. So the machinery of the government is absolutely crucial. If the machinery of the government does not work properly, then the private sector gets scared and the private sector stops investing, and then we get an economic decline.
So that's just a general query, actually not related to book maybe. But as in, if you allow the private sector, doesn't we miss out on the mass? As in, the private sector get access to the capital or maybe better service or maybe etc. Maybe like there's this theory that the rich gets richer and the poor gets poorer or whatever. So doesn't it?
So the most important problem in India is that we've got to get rich. Okay, so we can debate how to slice up the pie. We can debate how to slice up the pizza. But our number one problem is the pizza has to be made bigger. And that will only come through the private sector. So let me tell you a statistic. If you look at, so there is an international standardized concept of the poverty rate. Poverty is defined as consumption of less than $1 per person per day. Okay, so if a man is spending less than 70 rupees per day, that person is considered to be poor. And this is an international comparable value. I think all of us can agree. That's a reasonable definition. It turns out that 99% of the explanation of why the poverty rate of some country is high and some country is low, 99% of the explanation lies in one number. And that one number is the median income of the country. So to get rid of poverty, you've got to become rich. There's no other way. The overall country has to become rich. Now, after that, we can fight that should Mukesh Ambani have a house that is 26 floors or 13 floors? We can fight about that. But there is no escaping the fact that we need Mukesh Ambani to make wealth in India. That is the foundation.
Okay. So that means that to grow an economy, that is a general concept I would like to sum up with. That is, to grow an economy, you need to have a private sector to boost the private sector. But isn't it the government policy is not that supportive to private sectors in India? What is your take on that?
So there are two parts to this. One problem is central planning. Okay, central planning is where the government decides what is the technology. Okay, now this is extremely harmful because only private people know what is the correct technology. So the phrase used is picking winners. When government tries to say that this technology is better, when government tries to say this company is better, when government tries to say this industry is better, this always goes badly. Only private people know, only the competitive market knows what is the correct technology, what is the winning company who's going to succeed in a given market. When industry one competes with industry two, only the private sector knows how to do this, and the government should keep out. And this is a real problem in India, because every now and then the government will interfere in your life and it will tell you, no, I have decided this is the government technology that you will use. Okay, and that leads to stagnation. So central planning never works. Okay, Jawaharlal Nehru tried it. It did not work. Okay, we went for many decades, in the 60s, in the 70s, this worked very badly. Okay, and we thought that we are finished with this, but no, we are not. Even today, again and again, the government of India will decide, I know the technology, I will set up a company, I will make one more PSU, I will make a monopoly, I will tell you what to do. Okay, this is the problem number one. The problem number two is rule of law. Okay, at present in India now, if you think of CBI, Economic Offences Wing, SFIO, TEBI, RBI, Enforcement Directorate, Income Tax. You think of all these agencies that are there. The individual citizen of India is really in a very bad place. That if any of these agencies decides to come after you, then you are not safe. There is no more freedom in the country. So you cannot be a safe person when faced with these agencies. And that puts enormous power in the hands of these agencies. That makes the private person very uncomfortable. So many people would not like to build wealth. Many people would not like to show wealth, because then some sarkari official will come and grab your wealth. Many rich people in India are now telling their children, go abroad, build your business abroad, because you are safer abroad. Here in India, you will get tangled up with police and CBI and income tax and SEBI and whatnot. And then it's very difficult to do business in this kind of environment. So this is the rule of law problem. So there are two big problems that are holding back the private sector. One is central planning and the other is rule of law.
Okay. There is this chapter also in the art part of the book that is decentralization. So does it move as in, you mean to say that rather than centralizing, the state should give the power and they should rule how? Can you just throw a line in that?
Yeah. So ever since Nehru, we have had this idea that somehow the union government is better, that the union government is our leader. They will guide us. They will tell us what to do. And that's actually a deeply unsatisfying idea. And the reason is that India is so diverse. Okay, Kerala is completely different from Uttar Pradesh. Rajasthan is completely different from West Bengal, and so on. So it's much better to go to the constitution of India, the vision of the constitution, that different places are different, and each place should govern its own destiny. So in Maharashtra, the people of Maharashtra should think and decide. They have their own political preferences, and we have our own opinions on what are the problems in Maharashtra, and we should understand our problems in Maharashtra, and we should solve our problems in Maharashtra. Okay. So, for example, if you're in Kerala, by and large, schools work pretty well in Kerala. So that's not a big problem in Kerala. But if you are in Bihar, schools don't work in Bihar. So in Bihar, you want to see things very differently. So each place has its own different problems. And when we have a union government trying to do any one India, one scheme, one national program, one ration card for the whole country, one Aadhaar number for the whole country, these things become very insensitive to local conditions. Actually, each place is different. So we should look in our own backyard. Inside each 20 square kilometers, India is different. The problems are different. The solutions are different. We need to be far more decentralized in our approach. This is a bit like Gandhiji's concept of a village as the unit of organization. Each village is different. Let people think at the village level. Don't take instructions. Don't wait for some union government to tell you what to do. Okay? We should wake up. We should look at our world. We should understand our problems. We should debate. We should solve our problems. We should be in control of our own destiny. We should not be a subject who's ruled by some British empire. We should be free people. We look at the world. We decide. We make up our mind. We go.
So as in, we go a little bit in the history, there, I see there are there are people from different school of thoughts. Like one either praises the Nehru or either they don't praise Nehru. So according to you, Nehru made a mistake in making policy during independence.
So Nehru was not alone. We should emphasize that, roughly speaking, you know, in about 1920, yes, Gokhale handed over the Congress Party to Mahatma Gandhi and to Nehru. Okay, so from about 1920 to 1947, the greatest minds of India, they sat and thought about what we should do once we become free. Okay, and this is, they are great people. I admire those people. They looked at the world of that time and they came up with a certain plan. Okay, and it involved a lot of central planning. It involved power of the union government. It involved centralization. It involved a low role for the private sector. It involved deprioritizing personal freedom. Okay, with the benefit of hindsight, I think they were wrong. I think the centralization, the power of the union government, the reduction of the power of the person, of the citizen, of the individual, the lack of respect for the private sector, the centralization, I think all these things were wrong. And at the same time, you know, we should never lose sight. Nehru created Indian democracy. Okay, it would have been very easy for Nehru to become a dictatorship. It would have been very easy for Nehru to send income tax and CBI after his enemies. Okay, and he did not do that. So all of us have heard the story. The first time Atal Bihari Vajpayee did a speech in Parliament, Nehru went up to him and shook his hand and said, "This man is going to be Prime Minister one day." Okay, so that is the greatness of Nehru. Nehru fostered Indian democracy, and we would not have been a free country without Nehru consciously fostering freedom. And at the same time, on many questions, he was profoundly wrong. So we don't need to do hero worship. Okay, we should judge each person. They looked at a different time. The entire elite of the Indian National Congress, they were the leaders of India. They fought the freedom movement. They got the British out of the country. And they made a plan for what free India would look like. And with the benefit of hindsight, I think they were wrong on lots of things.
Okay, on this note, actually, I would like to ask, like you have mentioned, Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3 in the your book. Can you just talk about that, the different periods you have mentioned?
Thanks. That was exactly where I was, that the conception that Kelkar and I used is that from about 1920 till about 1947, the Indian National Congress built an intellectual philosophy of what we want India to be. And this we call Mark I. Okay? So that is the Constitution of India. That is the concepts of fundamental rights. And that is central planning, centralization, the lack of rule of law, the low importance of private sector, all these things. That was Mark I. And for some time, it worked pretty well. From 1947, at first, it worked very well for the 50s, and then it stopped working. Okay, and then things started going really badly in India. When things started going really badly in India, there was a wave of thinkers who diagnosed what was going wrong. Okay, and these were Arun Shuri, T.N. Srinivasan, Jagdish Bhagwati, Manmohan Singh, Monte Kaluwalya, Ashok Desai, all these people. Through the 60s and the 70s, they were writing, they were criticizing, they were building a new intellectual framework. Then in 1977, the Janata Party came to power, and that was the turning point where we made a break with the Mark I. So when the Janata Party came to power, Morarji Desai became the Prime Minister, H.M. Patel became the Finance Minister, and D.T. Lakrawala became the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission. And these three people started the process of turning India away from Mark I. And in 1980, when Indira Gandhi came back to power, she continued with this Mark II. And then when Rajiv Gandhi came to power, he continued with this Mark II. And then you got to Narasimha Rao in 1991, and then you got to Vajpayee in 1999. Okay, all this is what we call Mark II. So Mark II is about a greater role for the market economy, removing customs duties, welcoming foreign companies to operate in India, opening up on the capital account. Okay, many things were done. And in some ways, they worked great. From 1991 to 2011, for 20 years, we got the greatest growth that we have ever got in India's history. Okay, the most successful period in India's history was 91 to 2011. And we should all be very grateful to Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh and Vajpayee and Yashwant Sinha and Chidambaram and Jaswant Singh. These are the people who were the architects of this Mark II. And then we have to recognize it stopped working. Okay. So if you look at all the data, there is a turning point in roughly 2011 or 2012. Things started going wrong from about 2011 and 2012. And so what we argue in this book is that now we need a Mark III. Okay? So we need to understand that the Mark II is no longer working. 1991 to 2011, it worked. It was great. You know, nothing succeeds like success. If it's working, I admire it. But you've got to recognize that it's not working. That Indian growth has really got into a lot of trouble in the period after 2011. And now we need a new framework. We need a new paradigm. The name we give to this new paradigm is Mark III. And all of us should be working, thinking, debating what that third paradigm should be so that we can one day get back to 20 years of great growth once again.
So, as in not being too controversial, when we talk about the government, the present government, so are they not good enough perform as in and making the policy as in the boosting the economy right now?
So, what we feel is that what they are doing is more a continuation of a lot of these old problems. Okay, so say centralization, central planning, loss of rule of law, these things are continuing. So the faces change, the names on the policy change. Instead of a scheme with a name in English, now a scheme will have a name in Hindi. But other than that, it's more or less the same thing. So it's a very old-fashioned approach. They're not breaking new ideas. So if you say import substitution, that we will prevent foreigners from coming and operating in India, we will prevent imports from coming into India. This is what Nehru was doing in the 60s. It is not new. So our concern about this government is that it's a lot of the old things from Mark 1 and Mark 2, which are being intensified, where an English name is being converted to a Hindi name. That's not going to solve the problem.
Right. Again, coming to the science part, I would like to, there's this chapter that where you talk about incentives, people respond to incentives. Would like to know more about it.
This is an absolutely foundational concept in economics, that there is no deep feature of you or me which determines how we behave. Okay, how we behave is entirely about incentives. So for example, we complain that in India nobody pays attention to the street lights, and we will go through a red light on the road, or we will cross a road when I'm a pedestrian without ever looking for a light. But the same people, you and me, when we are driving in America, when we are driving in the UK, we are very careful, we will obey the light. Okay, why is that? Because if you go through a red light in America, the traffic cop will catch you and fine you $300. Okay, that's all. So there's nothing about you, there's nothing about me. Our behavior is just about incentives. So we should not think that there's something about us that is bad. Indians are not bad. Indians are as smart or as dumb or as good or as bad as anybody else in the world. It's just incentives. So why do officials of the Indian government misbehave? The answer is because they have the arbitrary power. Once you create arbitrary power, the official dumb will misbehave. Why does a policeman, an income tax officer, a financial regulator in the UK behave better? The answer is incentives. It is because their laws, their procedures reduce the amount of power of the official. They create more checks and balances. That is what makes them behave. So we should think hard about the incentives that various people operate under. We should not think that a person is good or a person is bad. Nobody is good and nobody is bad. We're all just people. We respond to incentives.
So it's all about changing the policy, as in discontinuing the current policy, coming in the Marxi according to you and Vijay Kelkar, right? Yeah. But in the art, if you go in the art, you have written like evolutionary change for society is revolutionary change for the government. Now you can throw light on that as well.
So very often in thinking about policy, we get what is called a revolutionary impulse, which again is a bit of Jawaharlal Nehru, where the idea is that I am in a hurry and I have very high hopes and optimism about dramatically changing the country, and I want it done tomorrow. Okay, now this is generally a bad idea because we don't know enough about how society works, and also because we should respect every person in the country. Okay, so partly it's a question of freedom, that I like to behave in certain ways. Don't tell me how to behave. Okay, so that's one part, that don't order people, don't tell people what to do. Every person should be free. Okay, the highest value of all is freedom. That we, each of us, should wake up in the morning and do whatever the hell we want. That's the greatest concept of nobility of state, where the people are free, where the people do whatever you want, where a government guy is not telling us what to do. That is the highest moral standard. So don't try to reshape society, because you will end up ordering people what to do. The second is that we don't know enough about society. You try to introduce a large change, it will always have unintended consequences. Okay, so the world is a complicated place. We don't understand it. It's better to be humble. It is better to make a small move, see the reaction, look at the data, half the time, apologize, admit that I was wrong, and change course. Okay. So to give you a recent example, in Punjab and Haryana, they passed a law which they thought was a law about water conservation. Okay. And in the process, what started happening is that the farmers started burning the fields. Okay. Now, nobody could have understood, nobody anticipated that. You thought that you're doing a water conservation law, and as a consequence, the entire North India now has a health disaster because of the burning of fields. Okay. The point is, we don't know enough about the world. We should not try to do big things. We should do small things. We should constantly look at the evidence, and we should be humble. We should, half the time, we should go back, do a speech to the people saying, "My people, sorry, I was wrong. I made a mistake. I'm reversing this." The hallmark of a great leader is the ability to say sorry, is the ability to say, "I made a mistake," and reverse yourself, because mistakes are a part of life. nobody can get it right in public policy.
When we talk about leader being humble, don't you think so? It's like tough for them to say sorry, as in there's this phrase I've heard about, as in the absolute power, as in power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Yeah. So is it possible for a leader to go and just apologize for his mistake?
Yeah. Look at Nehru, look at Vajpayee. Okay. We have had great leaders in the past. Look at Narasimha Rao. Okay. Look at Manmohan Singh. Okay. Soft, mild, modest, willing to be non-dogmatic, be willing to debate an idea, not be so caught up in your own pride. So yeah, it is possible to have great politicians who will be dispassionate, who will try to solve problems. So yeah, this is not too much to ask.
There's this one more chapter that is, it's a test match, not an IPL. That's like a pretty interesting name you've given to that chapter. Can you just throw a light on that chapter?
Yeah. So many times in India, we get this idea that, oh, there's a problem and I want to solve it by tomorrow. Okay. So I've been doing public policy all my life. And every now and then I'll get a phone call saying, now we want to solve this problem. So you give us a note, within 1 week, we'll make the announcement and then it's done. And I just want to say that's just not how it works. Life is slow. It's a long process to solve problems. So in the chapter, you will remember, we have an example of the river, the Rhine in Germany, where there was horrible pollution. There was a complete destruction of all life in the Rhine. And they cleaned the Rhine, and that's great. And it took 30 years. There's nothing wrong with that. It's better to actually solve a problem in 30 years rather than shout and make headlines for 30 days. Okay, actually solving problems takes a long time. There are no quick fixes. So whenever we get into a field, we should be playing a test match that, okay, this will take a long time. We need to build a community. We need to involve many people. We need to do debate, discussion, develop data sets, get good intellectuals to work on problems, figure out solutions. So this whole muscular approach that I want to solve a problem tomorrow is actually never going to solve a problem.
Right. Again, I'll come on one of the chapters that is about the GST, that is GST on low capacity scale. The perfect GST is on the low capacity scale. Can you just tell us something about that?
Vijay Kirikar and Arvind Modi and I were three of the pioneers on GST in India. So this is a subject very close to our heart.
Yeah.
And the key point is that when there is low state capacity, you have to keep the system extremely simple. Okay. And also you have to keep the rates very low. If the rate becomes high, then there is greater temptation for an official to do corruption. If the rate is kept low, then both the official and the firm will just say, look, it's simpler, I'm just going to do compliance. So what is a simple GST? One single rate. We think something like 8%. So keep the rate 8%. Keep it one single rate for everything, all goods, all services, only one rate. Have comprehensive invoice matching, and that's the way to build a GST that will work properly.
Okay. Right now, as the pandemic has hit, the economy of the whole world has actually got a dent. What exactly would you like to suggest to, again, revive the economy? Any suggestions you would like to?
So the first, there's a problem on the health side, and then there's a problem on the economic side. On the health side, I feel the government has not adequately appreciated the extent to which, for most of us, we go to private people when we have a health problem. Okay, you and I, we go to a private doctor, we go to a private clinic, we go to a private hospital, we go to a private testing lab, and so on. So for example, when a vaccine has to be pushed into the country, you and I are going to go get a vaccine from a private provider. So it's important to not think too much in terms of central planning, that the government will do this, the government will do that. In practice, the government has very low capability in India. Most of the actual work will be done by the private sector. We need to respect that. So, for example, the government should be saying that, yeah, private people will produce the vaccine, private people will sell the vaccine, a private doctor will come to your house and vaccinate you and your family members. And the government should be fine with that. Maybe the government should pay you a subsidy to go faster on the vaccination. But we should not get into the central planning mentality that the government is going to organize everybody's vaccination. The government does not have this capability. turning to the economic side, there has been a huge decline in the functioning of the economy, and lots of companies are in deep financial distress. Many financial firms are in a lot of trouble. And what I always like to say to my friends in the field of economic policy is, I say, suppose, hypothetically, magically, tomorrow, we vaccinate everybody in the country. Okay? So the pandemic is gone. But after that, there's going to be a huge economic problem with us, because financial firms are in trouble. Many, many non-financial firms are in trouble. Many, many household balance sheets have been damaged. So there is going to be quite a difficult journey in recovering the economy and getting back to employment growth. Employment growth has been doing badly for many years. So all the old problems remain with us of the post-2011 period. And actually, it has become a bit worse. So we have quite a battle in front of us on macroeconomic and financial policy. We are really going to need outstanding brain power and teams to come together in the government to figure out macroeconomics and financial policy.
Okay, we are actually coming to the end. So I would like to ask you something. Like, obviously, this book is a must read for everyone. This is like a guide or a Bible for policy making, or either understanding the policy or the economy right now. As it, but can you just suggest a few books which actually have you can recommend to our listeners, which has actually changed your mindset, or you would like to recommend to our, a must read for everyone?
Particularly for the persons in this group, I would. There's a bunch of books that are on my mind as interesting and important India books. Vinay Sitapati's book on Narasimha Rao is great. Jairam Ramesh's book on Narasimha Rao is great. Generally, Arun Shuri books are great. Arun Shuri is really a great thinker and a pioneer in many things that have been done in India. So these are some of the books that I would strongly recommend.
Okay. One more personal question. What exactly is the turning point in your life? What exactly has made you?
Well, I already told you my beginning, that my father was an economist and I was at IIT Bombay and I was deciding what to do, and I chose to do economics. So I guess that was one turning point. I think another big turning point was when Yashwant Sinha hired me to go into the Ministry of Finance. Until that, I was an academic. I spent 4 years in government. I worked for Yashwant Sinha and then Jaswant Singh and then Chidambaram, and I left in 2005. But those 4 years were really a formative time for me. I got to see the Indian state. I got to understand what works and what doesn't work. And then it really changed my mind about how to do public policy.
Okay. I think so. We are actually done with the time, right? I would it's a pleasure talking to you, Mr. Ajay Shah. It was really great talking to you, and actually, it's been an you have really shown a lot of light on economic policy making, which everyone has a lot of questions about. And I hope that the Mark III, what you've mentioned in your book, we soon realize and we do make new policies for a better economy. I would like to thank you so much, Mr. Ajay Shah, for being here and just giving us your inputs regarding this. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. It's a thank you for your hands. Yeah. On the behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 core. Rising group of institutions. A vision beyond.